Hello.
How are you?
Hello, Dr. Penberthy. I'm fine. How are you?
I'm good, thank you.
Thank you for taking the time to be here with us.
Of course.
Thanatos. Well, let's get going.
Sure.
I want to just very briefly introduce you. You're a professor in psychiatry and neurobehavioral sciences at the University of Virginia School of Medicine, also at the Department of Perceptual Studies. From my reading, I gather you got many roles at the university. So foremost, I think you're still, or you're a practicing psychologist. And then you're also very much involved with research. You published extensively on psychotherapy and mindfulness, which is one of your areas of interest, mm-hmm. and consciousness research. What is your role in DOBS, actually? What do you do for them?
In the Division of Perceptual Studies, I'm the Chester F. Carlson Professor, so that's an endowed chair. And with that comes the obligation and the opportunity to do research in the DOPS-related area. So a lot of my research started out being focused on meditation and extraordinary experiences, mystical experiences that come out of intentional meditation, so exercises. And I also have experience looking at reports of after-death communication. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So this was a newer area of study for me that I've always been interested in for multiple reasons, scientific reasons, and also personal reasons. And so I was thrilled a couple of years ago to be able to collaborate with colleagues and do a larger study of, you know, a survey study asking people about their after-death communications, mm-hmm, and looking not just at who reports that, although that's quite important. We don't really know a lot about who experiences these things and who reports them and what they are. We looked at that and had thousands of people, and also looked at what is the ramification of that. You know, not just do you have this and what is it like, but also then what impact has it had on your life? Mm-hmm. And to me, that was quite profound. It helps reduce fear of death and dying. Mm-hmm. If you have these after-death experiences, for many people, it was very comforting. They felt less grief or a different kind of grief. It helped them move through that loss.
So this is the research that where you collaborate with the Europeans on the after-death communications.
Correct.
What kind of after-death communications do people actually experience?
Well, that's a really good question. So I think the first thing to think about is that there are a couple of ways of looking at this. So some people induce after-death communications. So you can go to a medium, you can go to a seance, you can participate with a Ouija board. So you could do this, you know, with that intent. What we studied was different than that. It was a spontaneous. So mm-hmm. these would be communications from someone that has passed that happened spontaneously. And what we see is that there's a variety of these. So we looked at all of it. We had the individuals describe in as much detail as they could exactly what happened. And then we can categorize them. So you can be literally visited by, you know, an image, a visual sort of thing of a person or animal. It's often mm-hmm. frequently reported birds, things like that come, you know, and maybe even had been foretold by the person who died, uh-huh. You know, but they represent somehow that individual. It can be a voice. You can hear someone, and you know that it's, you know, it's perceived as real, and yet no one else hears it. Sometimes other people can. Sometimes other people can see what you're seeing as well. That's often the case. So there's also, you know, a myriad of probably as many different ways as you can think of individuals. Aromas coming back. Some people report, you know, I walked into the room and smelled the food my grandmother would would prepare, and I knew she was there. It can be touched. These are the ones that are really seem to have the most impact, is if there's a physical sensation of touch, or you know, a brush against the face or something like that. Those seem to be, when we look at them, even more powerful in changing beliefs, specifically about life after death.
So it's these kind of experiences which then enforce the, yeah, the belief in life after death in people, and gives them obviously comfort as well. And the conviction, I guess, or the belief, the hope that they will meet the person again who's passed on.
And there's a sense that that other individual personality is well or safe, or not just continuing, but also, you know,
fine, content doing well
in some way. So that is what I hear a lot, that people are just happy to know, not only that they're still there, which is what they'd hoped and believed, that that they are also like sense that they're okay, so to speak.
I just want to bring you back to the Department of Perceptual Studies, and I guess one of the big topics there, which are the near-death experiences.
Correct.
You write about near-death experiences in your book, Living Mindfully Across the Lifespan.
Yes.
With your, you co-authored that with your daughter, Megan. And in the last chapters, you mentioned near-death experiences, also in the context of death and dying, and in the context of fear of death. What's your general view on near-death experiences? How do you rate the value and the relevance of near-death experiences in general?
I find near-death experiences very interesting. And again, similar to the after-death communication, I think as a scientist, it's very helpful to identify exactly what you're talking about. I do believe there's something there that violates our physicalist sort of idea, that idea that when our body dies, it sort of shuts off the lights and everything is gone and we don't exist anymore. My experience is that as a scientist, I believe something is happening where the aspects of the brain that is acting sort of as a, for lack of a better word, a filter or transmitter or something, those have been removed. And so the access to this sort of global consciousness, if you will, is available. And that, you know, that may be what is accessed then and experienced. And because the person then returns to their physical body, they are able in a limited way to explain it. Many of them say the words can't capture it, which is understandable. If you look at other areas of science where the focus is on this idea that consciousness is what there is, and that we are somehow only accessing a small part of it, this would make sense. And that there are times when we can access that larger, larger is a bad word because it's infinite, but that we can access that we're limited when we're in our physical bodies. And yet we can in many ways, some ways, access it. A near-death experience, certainly. Some psychedelic drugs, which is another budding interest of mine, where you may be able to access it. Some mystical experiences, either spontaneous, that sort of just occur, or that are induced through meditation, as I said, you know, psychedelic drugs, breathing. So these different ways that we may be able to access a little taste of it. And in my mind, all of those are quote unquote real, And thus, you know, near-death experiences would be in that category as well.
So you would say that it's sort of a spectrum of experiences. And on this spectrum and this great variety of near-death experiences is just one. And it's in many ways similar to other experiences people may have without actually having a near-death experience. So I think I heard some people spontaneous may have an out-of-body experience, but not a near-death experience.
Correct.
Or right. Have mystical experiences. How do you see the near-death experiences, or actually all of these experiences, in the wider context of all the paranormal, transcendental, mystical experiences?
I see them all related in that they seem to support a different idea about reality and the universe and consciousness mm-hmm. than the sort of predominant physicalism type of approach. So they all, in my mind, match up better to some of the more current advanced science that we're seeing in physics, for instance, in quantum mechanics. Many of these things support that our view of reality is limited, to say the least, and that there may be other ways of understanding consciousness and the universe and reality that are in line with all of these things. Mm-hmm. For instance, there's something biocentrism, which talks about includes sort of physics and really talks about that perhaps we create reality by observing it. So this is coming from work along the lines of Dean Radin and people at IONS, the sort of double split exercises where we see that reality, it changes based on an observer. Mm-hmm. And we are the observer. And so it just lends itself to this idea that perhaps there is this larger consciousness that is the universe. And I do believe we are moving in that direction, mm-hmm. ironically bolstered by not social science or even necessarily religious sciences, but the science of physics, mm-hmm. which is really interesting to me. So all the young people out there, please study physics, please.
And what about the conventional views, which are still steeped in materialism, which means when the brain goes, when we die, consciousness is gone as well? What can you hold against that old paradigm?
I'm not an expert in the physics of it all.
Yeah.
However, you know, the reading I've done and explored really demonstrates that we don't have a satisfactory way of explaining how on Earth consciousness could arise from matter. Mm-hmm. And that is, you know, as many people are aware of, that's the sort of big question, the really complicated, hard question. So I think that right there tells you that we're missing something. And I also think that it's important to, you know, as scientists and rational people, it's important to look at what is right in front of your eyes. What are people reporting? And I think this is why it's so important, the work that DOPS does, the work that people are doing around the world, my colleagues in Europe and beyond, where we are collecting data, mm-hmm. because, you know, after a while, my hope is people will see, well, maybe something really is going on here that is different than this physicalist view. If all of these people are reporting this, something is happening worth looking at. And we may be able to approach it from that direction to sort of make a change. What makes sense based on what we're seeing?
Talking more about then your personal field of work, which is therapy, mindfulness, contemplation, how can this field then contribute to consciousness research? So for example, is it possible to, through practices, generate some extraordinary states of consciousness or experiences?
Absolutely, absolutely. I have been teaching various forms of meditation to my patients and seeing remarkable impacts. What I do is a combination of therapeutic interventions that have been shown to be effective for many of their presentations. And increasingly what we're finding are these contemplative interventions are also part of that package and really help quite a bit.
Can you explain these different terms of meditation, sure, contemplation?
Sure. So the way I'm using the terminology, I would say contemplative practices would be the umbrella. So these are practices that would include some component of contemplation, some component of sort of what in psychology we call them contextual therapies. They're sort of being able to use a perspective, stepping back. So being mindful is one of them under that umbrella. That mindfulness I teach would be versions of mindfulness-based stress reduction, mindfulness-based cognitive therapy, where you bring that component of being present on purpose in a non-judgmental way, just being present in your self and using that as sort of a launching pad for additional work, whether that's deeper meditation. So the meditation, I work with people doing different versions of meditation. So we may work together to find out what works best for them. Is it a breathing meditation? Is it some sort, you know, Vipassana type of thing? Is it something more active? Like, do they need breath work? These things. So I will usually tailor that to the individual so that we can get something that they actually can do to achieve this sort of state of mind, which is in my view, a way to access some of these experiences, these transcendental experiences, these mystical experiences. I am interested in learning more about psychedelic, the use of psychedelics to assist in psychotherapy, which is growing across the US.
What are some of the insights there or results?
Well, part of what they're doing is having to train people to do this therapy first, because to do the clinical trials, we're now being able to do more of the clinical trials that we've not been able to do before. So that's the research to study this. And there are organizations, I'm consulting with one of them, there are organizations who are working hard to develop strategies to sort of match the psychedelic drug with a therapeutic component, because you have to have it in that context again. You don't just give someone MDMA, you know, which is sometimes known as ecstasy. You know, you don't give people ketamine, these things, and then just say, you know, good luck, enjoy. So there's thought being put into what sort of experience do they need to have, both sort of environmentally, also therapeutically. And we are fortunate we have access to research that's been done looking at, you know, treatment for PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, treatment for chronic depression. And can we take the best of what's there in therapy and pair it with what we suspect would work from the psychedelic drugs version and create an entire approach with the intention that it does create this sort of mystical experience? I mean, mm-hmm. That's part of why I want to be involved, is make sure that that doesn't get left out, because mm-hmm. I'm fairly certain to, you know, my hope is we can research this, but my hunch would be that that is a component that is really necessary and important.
And would you have different substances to choose from, which you then use and tailor and choose for different problems or aims?
Yes, that's the idea, at least with most of these companies, that they see the characteristics of the psychedelic impact and, you know, what would be most beneficial, say, for someone with post-traumatic stress, which is an anxiety disorder where people are hypervigilant, and something that works for them may not be as effective for someone with something like chronic depression, where they're very demotivated, they're very lethargic, they're not active. So, you know, they may need something different as far as an experience. However, I think it will be interesting as this progresses to see if there is a commonality of this mystical experience, this transcendental experience that's very positive and sort of that is the magic ingredient, so to speak. It would be very interesting to see if that is the component.
Mm-hmm. Do you think it can generate these experiences?
I believe so. Uh-huh. I hope to find out more. Yeah. I think that these experiences can be generated by humans in a multitude of ways. Mm-hmm. Personally, I've had what I would consider a mystical experience when I was out on a beautiful lake with my husband. Mm-hmm. And literally just exercising, just paddling on a stand-up paddleboard. And I had this profound sense of contentment, of unity, that I was not different than the lake. I was not different than the sky, than the osprey flying, than my husband. And I just, it was this intense bliss and connection. And it really was a sense. And I remember thinking, have I gone to heaven? Have I died? Mm-hmm. What has happened? Because it was so profound and so different, this connection. And I really thought, maybe I died on this paddleboard and I'm feeling, but it's wonderful. It's wonderful. And I wasn't dead. It was just this intensity. And I've heard from other people that they can achieve that, that mystical type of experience in nature, mm-hmm. you know, where you encounter something that feels so connected. It's so profound. So I think that we may be talking about a similar thing to the near-death experiences, to these out-of-body experiences, to these intense mystical experiences. And maybe they're along a continuum. I'm sure they are. And yet it's part of the same substance, it feels like. Mm-hmm. I feel like I can look at the outcomes. I can say, well, what's the impact of that? And measure that to some degree. It's imperfect. It's somewhere to start. And that's a lot of what we're doing at DOPS is mm-hmm. taking these reports, collecting them, looking at what connects them, what is similar, and what are the similar outcomes that we have. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, then we also have people looking at the science. Well, what is going on? My colleague, Dr. Kelly, looking at, well, what is happening in the brain? Mm-hmm. Is the same thing happening, that we're all sort of going offline? That's what's happening, maybe, that our brain is sort of getting out of the way so we can access this. That's a beautiful thought, and it sort of would make sense. And so we've got people like him looking at that as well. What is mm-hmm. happening? You know, mm-hmm.
is this during meditation or during mystical experiences in general, or?
Right. I mean, I think we need to find out, you know. My hunch is that it's sort of veering to that area of sort of shutting down things, and similar to what you might see in a patient who's died or nearly died, or in someone having meditative experiences where they sort of clear their mind down, shut it down. So I think we don't have enough of the research to show mm-hmm. Exactly what is happening. But to me, that would make sense, that if we're thinking that there is something out there we're all accessing, this universal component, and it's all connected, it's all energy, say, which we know everything now is energy, then it may make sense that if our physical, physiological brains are sort of filtering it, we can't access it quite as well. And yet if we learn how to, or we just have an experience that does it on its own, sort of shut that down, mm-hmm. we can access this. the state. And perhaps that's what happened to me on that lake. I mean, it, you know, I have thought about that. I wish I had had a little EEG cap on and we could see what was happening. And I have wondered, well, did I just have this, was I in a meditative state without even knowing it? You know, which we know we can do. We can get into that state, you know, and that's what happened then. I spontaneously sort of accessed this.
But you actually done studies where you try to replicate some of these experiences or sort of measure these experiences, how many people have special experiences, extraordinary experiences brought about meditation.
That's more challenging because it does take some skill, and unless you find the person who can spontaneously do this. So the studies that I've been conducting have been looking at what sort of what and other researchers have done this as well, looking at, well, is there a threshold of sort of exposure and experience that you need in order to achieve these states of mind or states of consciousness? Because we know trained specialists who've, you know, monks and people who have done this for years can certainly achieve this, these states. We do know that. The question is, Does that what it takes? Does it take a lifetime of this? Or can people achieve it with lower amounts of training or practice? And that sort of approach was first taken for things like meditation and mindfulness-based interventions to say, well, you know, they were looking more at things like blood pressure, you know, physiological responses or mood responses, anxiety levels, depression levels. So looking at how much does it take of training someone to do these meditations or this mindfulness work in order to get responses. And, you know, no surprise, it took about 8 weeks for the MBSR, the mindfulness-based stress reduction, to have an impact on reducing stress, improving response to pain, that sort of thing. Now, 8 weeks, that's not very long in my book. It's long for some people, but my hunch is it's going to take longer than 8 weeks of meditation to impact something like a transcendental state or a mystical experience and have access to that reliably. So my hunch is it's somewhere between 8 weeks and a lifetime. Yeah. And then again, it may be that there is something else that is required as well, above and beyond motivation. I mean, are there people that naturally have this ability? And why would that be? And I don't know that we have the answers to that yet. Some people certainly are easier to hypnotize, to get into a trance than others. Some are more suggestible than others. Some are more open. So there are characteristics like this that we're also looking at. You know, are there particular people who are more likely to experience a near-death experience or have an out-of-body experience? And so far, you know, we're finding a little bit of what you might predict of often is the people who are more open to new experiences. But again, we don't know. Is that just because they're the only ones reporting it? Maybe other people who are more shy, closed, not interested in sharing their information are having these and just not letting us know. That's why I think it's important for us to continue to do large survey studies where we really try to ask people not just to volunteer the information, but we just sort of go out and survey people and say, you know, we're asking these questions and please respond no matter what, whether you've had one of these experiences or not, to try to find out a little bit more about individuals who do.
You also help a lot of people with physical diseases, with chronic diseases, with chronic pain, I think cancer patients. How does mindfulness, contemplative practices help in that regard?
These kinds of approaches are different because we are, especially in something like pain, we're going to be approaching it as not something to change or avoid or run away from, but really something to learn to live with. Many of the patients I see in the cancer center who have pain are not going to be able to get rid of their pain. It's neuropathic pain. It's pain created by the treatment for the disease often. So they are, you know, coming to me because no medicine will work and no medicine will likely ever work. And so we need to find a way to be with this. And we use sort of acceptance-based and mindfulness-based approaches to helping them be with it. And often that is getting into sort of a state of mind where they can sort of distance themselves. They can access something bigger than themselves. So they can comprehend being more than just their body, which helps them then. They still have the same amount of pain. We're not reducing their pain. We're just helping them live with it in a more satisfactory way. That's sort of more focused on connecting to other things and having access to these other experiences instead of just focusing on the pain. Mm-hmm. And for the people I work with palliative care, so these are people who are actively dying and their family members who we have to sort of help come to understand that their loved one is dying. I do a combination of work. Often it is going to be sort of talking to them about their beliefs in what happens when their body dies and exploring with them ways to think about how they can incorporate death into their frame of reference. And so that might mean for someone who has a sense, exploring that with them in a way that they can accommodate it more, they can focus on it more. And for someone who doesn't, which I'm increasingly finding many people just have not thought about it. They may not be religious. Many people now are, you know, not as affiliated with a religious system of thinking. And so they approach this really unprepared, not knowing, you know, very fearful of not just death, but pain that comes with it. And so really helping people explore this sort of their metaphysical beliefs for the first time sometimes, mm-hmm. and offering some components that I really feel have impacted people's lives in such amazing ways because they've heard me open up about this. Uh-huh. You know, they've never heard one of their doctors talk about, well, have you ever thought that maybe you do exist beyond the death of your body? You know, they're just like big eyes, you know. really? I'm allowed to think that? Is that possible? You know, and so we often implement that in the therapeutic approach to help them begin to expand. And I even bring in, you know, readings of and they, you know, for many of them, science has become their religion. Mm-hmm. And yet it's the limited science that they've been exposed to. And so I bring in more advanced science and I say, okay, if this is what you believe and trust, look here. Mm-hmm. This is mm-hmm. pretty amazing, isn't it? You know,
I'm curious, how do patients find you?
You mean literally?
Yeah, literally with these problems.
Well, I have been there since 1998.
Yeah.
And know most of the physicians who I work with. And so I am referred patients every day. And I think they find me because I've been there a while, word of mouth from other colleagues and friends and family and of patients and my colleagues. And I think patients report, I know patients report back to their other doctors, mm-hmm. not necessarily all the details of what we spoke about. They often report back, she you know, gave me something more than I was getting from all the other doctors. And that's what they hear and they like. It makes their life easier. You know, the oncologist or the surgeon is very happy to have these patients come to me because they don't know what they need
is this
to do.
Is this the sort of connection with the cancer center and
correct? Yes,
via the university, and then they perhaps see somebody who's struggling with the whole situation and then refer them on to you because they know that can be helpful.
Absolutely. Mm. And for a long time, we had, we often have these interdisciplinary teams where, you know, we have chaplains, we have the oncologist, we have social workers, we have myself. So we are working together and really quite aware of, you know, we can speak about each patient and really discuss what they need to have a comprehensive treatment approach. And we're really proud of that, that we can offer that. And that's a way I get to meet these people as well.
About death and dying, why do you think death and dying is such a taboo topic in general?
I think because we're so focused on youth and vitality, and that is sort of equated with success, especially in, I think, America. And the structure of our culture also has changed. You know, we don't really have access to seeing older people and glorifying their lives. Many of us, you know, move away from our family of origin, and then our children move away from us, and we're sort of living in these what would be called successful. We're productive. We're, you know, we might be doing quite well in our jobs. We might still have a spouse, or we might leave that spouse to find a better spouse, you know, and we're sort of trucking along, and we really sort of sideline the older individuals, the people that are sort of more likely to die. And we're not around them very much. We don't see them decline. We don't, we're not there towards the end of their lives. And so I think we diminish it. We don't value it. And we value that sort of middle parts, that, you know, productive, busy, buying things, building homes, you know, driving fast cars. And many of our older people that are near death are not doing that. And I think it's a shame. And so therefore, I think it's anything you're not familiar with is foreign and scary, and you avoid it.
Yeah. Do you come across a lot of anxiety and fear of death and dying?
It's mixed. Most often, and I think this is confirmed in the literature, it's people are afraid of the pain of what that process will be like, of being neglected or abandoned or having a lot of physical pain. It's sort of that process that is scary. And then you have typically the people that are really afraid of just death, of not existing anymore. Mm-hmm. And that's very hard for them to comprehend because they have no other framework to sort of accommodate that. And so that's sort of the basis of terror management theory, mm-hmm. Which is a common psychological approach that's been shown to be, you know, really helpful in treating people with fear of death and dying, is that you manage the terror. I mean, there's the hypothesis that the terror is a natural thing if you believe in this physicalist approach. I mean, who wouldn't be like sort of terrifying, scared about that? Like, wait, yeah, you're telling me I'm never coming back. It's all over, you know? And the terror management component is you manage the terror by incorporating death and dying as part of this comprehensive way of thinking, this metaphysical approach. And so you often see rituals as part of that. You see, you know, I think of the Native Americans of America in the US, you know, or North America, elaborate sort of processes and myths or beliefs about what happens with death. And it's not as scary because there's this whole community understanding what the process is and what they'll do next. And so, as I said, with people being less religious and more based on science, especially this sort of physicalist approach, you can understand why there might be an increase of a fear of death and dying, and an increase in these really elaborate and excessive efforts to continue life at all cost. And we see that here in the US, you know, the majority of money that is spent in healthcare is spent at the end of life. So these extraordinary efforts, and I see it all the time in oncology. My husband is also, he's a radiation oncologist, so he's also involved in oncology care. And we see, you know, just frantic efforts in the last 3 weeks of life to extend life, and life is extended, and its quality is quite poor. And, you know, it's often an ethical and moral type of thing we have to think about, you know, is there a better way that we could approach this?
Have you found ways of helping these people? Or is it difficult to shift? I think it probably is to influence people's minds, convictions, beliefs.
Especially at the family members, often it's quite difficult, you know, because you're also often interacting with people when they are at this really heightened emotional state. And yes, I would have to agree with you that it is much more challenging, especially if people have, you know, lived their entire life with this belief that my brain is physically responsible for producing my mind. And now when my brain is dead and my body is dead, I die. I'm gone forever. It's hard, although not impossible, but that's why I think we need to get information out about this. And I'm so glad we are increasingly doing so. We need to keep putting information out there. We need to keep inviting people to explore these ideas. Yeah. And in my book that I wrote with my daughter, we did this intentionally. We combined sort of mainstream components of psychology with some of these other ways of thinking. And we really blended them in a way that you might get someone who's never thought about the mind or consciousness continuing after death. And they would perhaps buy this book and then be exposed to an idea that, because they believed in all the other parts of the book, they say, well, this seems reasonable. So my hope is we can not only preach to the choir, to people who already believe or at least think, you know, of possibilities, that we also make efforts to do exactly what you were referring to try to understand other people who have been raised with this view, this physicalist view, and can we help them explore some other ideas? And that might mean just a little at a time, you know, just one little seed dropped in that maybe grows a bit. Many folks that I've worked with would be overwhelming to hear all of this, to learn of near-death experiences and to be exposed to all of that. However, we can get a little foot in the door by sort of weaving it in with other things that they are more familiar with. So that's how I have approached it in my work with the general population. And it's also very interesting and important to pay attention to your, you know, for me, my openness and my stance, because I find when I'm open and accepting, people will share, and they will often share things that they've never shared with any of their other doctors, because they thought the doctors would think they were crazy. And so I'm quite aware of that, of really being open and receptive to whatever people may bring, and letting them sort of explore that.
Some of the studies I read about that you've been conducting, they were mainly, I think, quantitative. And then on the other hand, there's these experiences you may have and pick up and patients share with you. And correct me if I'm wrong, it's sort of the qualitative experience, the actual experience that people have, which make it alive, which make it real. Mm-hmm. But then again, we're looking at the numbers, at the significance to attach some value to these experiences. How is it possible to get the right balance between these two approaches?
That is a really good question. I think personally, both are important. And because it is the individual whose life we're talking about, whose experience we're describing. And that is very important to that individual. And accumulating those stories of individuals is a scientific approach. I mean, as you said, they're different, and they're both, you know, ways of exploring our world. Qualitative is more of a descriptive. Quantitative is collecting the information in sort of larger ways, in a structured way, where we can sort of compare things and look at statistical significance. And so I do think moving forward, we need both. And I say that because I think you sort of change. I think what we need is shift societally in our sort of openness or even acceptance to some of these ideas, in order to sort of shift our own metaphysical framework that's predominant. And I think that will then open up all kinds of possibilities when you have mainstream funding sources willing to fund ideas like this. So that's where I think the quantitative research helps us to sort of speak, to create that bridge, similar to what I was talking about with my book. Mm. I mean, we need the people that have already been converted, so to speak, on board, and we need others, and we need to sort of shift. And so how do you convert others? You meet them where they are. Mm-hmm. And then you sort of take them with you to show them other things, with them trusting you, with them believing you, with them having reason to do so. And so I think that's how we can move forward in this research, both at DOPS and you know, globally. And I think, you know, I don't want to sound too grandiose. I do think that this is one of the most important things we have on the horizon for humanity.
We talked about after death communications earlier. Can I bring you back and can you outline the study that you're involved with?
So, this was a large survey study, and we had fairly extensive questions asked in multiple countries. You know, really the idea was we were trying to look at not just one group of people where maybe this is more common, but really look at it globally to the extent we could. And really it was an imperfect study, obviously. Many are, because they, you know, we're just starting in more detailed research here. This was quantitative. So it was looking at, you know, collecting specific data points from large numbers of people. I say it was imperfect because we're asking individuals to share if they've had an after-death communication. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're really just trying to sort of hear from the people who endorse this. And I say that that's imperfect because then you get the people who are willing to fill out this very lengthy questionnaire, go online and share their story. And it was no small feat. It was a quite extensive questionnaire. And so, you know, you do have potentially a motivated group of people who do this. Nevertheless, the data that came out was really pretty extraordinary in the, you know, the predominance of number one, people willing to do this and sharing pretty profound and intense experiences that they had, and to find that they found them really beneficial for their own well-being and mental health is pretty impressive as well. Because, you know, I'll be very honest, it's more common for me now to hear about these things from my patients. However, when I speak to my colleagues who are psychologists or healthcare workers, they don't hear about this very often. And I think I'm very curious, you know, when I'm about who is experiencing this and what sort of impact does it have and what does it mean? When I go to cocktail parties, you know, I don't always hear about it, but every once in a while you will get a brave soul who will offer something up. My hunch is it's more common than we might think.
How common is it according to the studies?
Well, see, the thing is, we've got, you know, we're only collecting data from people who are endorsing it. So, it's a little bit difficult to understand. I also am really curious about how people interpret it. What does it mean to them? And in talking to individuals, they sort of stop at a certain level. They say, oh, it means that my loved ones still exist. It means they want good things for me. It means they're watching over me. And yet the deeper ones of, well, what does it mean, you know, metaphysically, they don't go there, you know? I find that sort of interesting. And I think we need to have more robust conversations about that. Well, what does that mean if you are experiencing someone who is supposed to be, you know, not existing anymore?
It's like not going any further and not thinking about, well, what are actually the consequences for me, for my life, for everything, really, because if we're certain that we continue to exist, that has a whole lot of consequences for our lives now as well.
Absolutely. And that's what I hope to awaken people to. How might that, you know, change your life and the actions you take and the way you approach other people, the environment, engage in your community.
Yeah, you're really excited and enthusiastic about mindfulness, all these topics, transcendental experiences, consciousness. Where does this enthusiasm come from? Have you always been interested in this field?
I have, yes. I attribute it to my unique combination of parents. I think my mother would have been, I don't know, a Wiccan or something like that if she knew what that was. She was very close to nature and really knew, was sort of a natural naturopath, you know, really understood nature. And one of my first memories is going with her and lying on the grass in this big meadow, which was our front yard, and face down, just hugging the earth. And she was saying, you know, just feel the power of the earth, of Mother Earth supporting you and taking care of you. And this will always be here. And so there was this openness to some of this stuff. I remember asking her if there were angels and all these very complicated questions, you know, what was the purpose of life and all of these things? And she had just wonderful, open answers that allowed me to explore what I felt might be true. And then I had a father who's a cardiothoracic surgeon, very science-based, who, you know, when I asked him the purpose of life, he said, oh, that's really easy. And I was like, wow, okay, great. Tell me. He said, it's to reproduce. And so I had this wonderful juxtaposition of, you know, the biology of life and this other sort of cosmic approach of oneness and responsibility to the earth and connection with it and others. And, you know, I grew up in an old house that was, well, old for American standards, built in the 1800s. And we had experiences that nobody could explain. It's in a part of America where you had the Civil War conflict right in that town, where brother fighting brother, cousin fighting cousin in the American Civil War. And so a lot of energy around that. And our house had at one point housed many of these soldiers and even before that. And so we would have experiences and see things that we were just allowed to be aware of and open to and accept for, you know, what it was, which was sort of, we couldn't really explain, but we assumed it was some resonance, some energy.
What kind of, what sorts of experiences?
Well, some were not so good. I was smacked and literally had no one in the house. It was a lightning and thunderstorm, and I was up in a room and my other family were down on the porch watching the storm coming, and there was a smack that I had across my face, and I turned around thinking it was my little brother and I was going to go kill him, and and there was nobody there. I immediately was like crying because it hurt. And I ran to my mother and she said, oh, it must be the little boy in the picture. There was an old picture where they had taken a photo of the family and everyone had been outside the house with all their objects. You know, in that time you bring your prized possession with you. So people had chairs and trays and cows and things like that. He was up in that room that I had been in pouting. And it said so on the back of the picture. We found, you know, all the list of people and their belongings. And then it had him up in the room pouting because he wouldn't come out. And so that's what we just went with, that it must have been him smacking me. I you know, and I believe that to this day. I mean, I have no other explanation. So there were other things too, objects that moved and things like that. But we were allowed, I guess my point was, because I was exposed to that so young and it didn't seem scary or weird or inconceivable, and we could talk about it, I just sort of accepted it. My father also got me reading Kurt Vonnegut at a young age. And I found Emanuel Swedenborg's works. And, you know, this all just sort of fed me and made me realize the most important thing I realized is that I don't know it all. And that there are probably things happening that I'm not aware of, that I can't perceive. We also grew up on a farm and it was very clear other animals were perceiving things that I couldn't perceive. Dogs that heard things I couldn't hear. Animals that sensed and moved away from things that I was impervious to. So, you know, all of this makes you really understand how amazingly intricate and expansive our world is, and that we only understand or comprehend a little sliver of it. Mm-hmm. And even with that little sliver, it's also just remarkably wonderful. And I've had that experience too, of just profound contentment and comfort. And I think that has helped as well, because I'm also acutely aware that without that sense of safety, and unfortunately there are many, many people that I see who are profoundly lacking that, without that, it is hard to trust. Mm-hmm. It is hard to be open. Mm-hmm. And experience these sort of states of consciousness.
Mm-hmm. At the end of your book, you relate an experience you had together with your mother, I think, in your 20s at the beach. Would you like to share that with us?
Yes, absolutely.
I think it was very interesting experience.
Yes. So my mother and I were at the beach, the coast of the U.S. in North Carolina. And it was just the two of us. We loved the beach, so we'd often go just the two of us. And we were lying on the sand, and there it gets very warm and it's lovely. And I was drowsy, and so we're lying there. I put a towel over my face so I don't burn my face. And she murmured that she was going to go swimming, so she went off to swim. I believe probably fell asleep. And I woke to some murmuring sort of further down the beach, but then it got louder. And so I decided, okay, maybe something's going on. What's that happening? And got up on my elbows and let the towel fall away and looked out to the ocean. There was certainly a group of people. And then I saw that there was, the lifeguard was out there too, because they're obvious with their red lifeguard outfits. And he was carrying my mother out of the sea. And there was another man on the other side of her also carrying her. And it looked odd because he was much older and he was in clothing, like khakis, like sort of baggy or khakis and a shirt, a button up shirt. And I saw though that she was okay. And I was still sort of groggy and not sure. And I thought, what is happening? And I thought, well, they've got it covered. I mean, there's not much I can offer. So I stayed put and laid back down. And she came over and laid down. And she said, no, don't. You know, I started to get up. She said, I'm fine. Lay back down. And I said something like, you know, well, what happened? And she said she'd gotten caught in the rip current there. It goes out to the Gulf Stream. And although she's a strong swimmer, it pulled her under. And I said, well, who was helping you in? Who's that old man? And she just said, that was my grandfather. And that's all we said about it. Mm-hmm. I might have said, oh, I don't know. I didn't. And again, because we'd grown up with things like this that just were not, you know, I remember telling that story to friends and they were like, well, didn't you, weren't you just asking her all kinds of questions? Weren't you just amazed? And I said, no, I just accepted it. And I had not met him. He died before I was born. And when we got back to my parents' home, I did find a picture of him, and it certainly was him, absolutely. She did not have it out on display or anything like that. I would have never have been able to know who he was other than I saw him bringing her in. And she obviously endorsed experiencing it as well. I mean, she endorsed that was her grandfather bringing her in. So, and we sort of left it at that. We didn't really speak much about it. And now she's not with us. She's passed away. I can't ask her many more questions about it. So, and I think what I wrote in the book, it holds so true, is that I don't understand what happened. I mean, certainly there's some energy resonating, someone who cared for her. And she was raised by her grandparents due to some unfortunate circumstances. He cared for her deeply. They were very close. And to me, I explained it that there was some energy that was still existing that came back to assure she was okay. Similar to when people report, you know, a cardinal came and I know that was my mother and she came to check on me, or, you know, something along those lines, that there's some representation. I just happened to have seen it and my mother happened to have seen it as his, you know, a version of his former physical body. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I didn't really think of it as a ghost. I think of it as that energy in a form that we could see, that she could be reassured by.
Yeah.
That she, you know.
Yeah.
And for whatever reason, I was connected enough to see it as well. Did everyone else on the beach see it? I have no idea.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe some of them did. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. Final question. What does the future hold? What are your plans in all this, in this type of research, consciousness, mindfulness?
Oh, there's so much to do. I think one of the most important things is recruiting other people. So this is why I'm so happy you're doing the work you're doing, your organization. Spreading the word is going to be important because we need more people involved. We certainly can't do all the research on our own. I think more research needs to be done on how we access these states of mind, and continuing to explore that and look at the impact. And as I said, way beyond my abilities, but very important are these the people that continue to make progress in these advanced sciences like physics, and helping us to sort of look at, does this, you know, what version of consciousness and the universe accommodates these experiences? Because there are versions that do. And how can we sort of make that shift towards this different view of reality that matches what we are literally seeing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for spending time with me and giving us your fascinating insights and the experiences as well. I think that's really fascinating.
I'm honored. And I want to say thank you for the work you do. I mean that sincerely. It's so important.
All the best and success in your work. And I hope you can contribute a lot in the future to this. Thank you.
Take care. Be well.